Welcome to the Skeptic Zone, the podcast from Australia for science and reason.
Yes, it's the Skeptic Zone podcast, episode number 760 for the 30th of April, 2023. Richard Saunders coming to you this week from Bend, Oregon, from the headquarters of the Skeptoid podcast. I'm having a few days to get over jet lag with my good buddy, Brian Dunning. And we've already sampled a few of the wonderful local beers here in Bend. And he tried to beat me at pool. But that's a story for another day. What, however, are the stories for today? On this week's episode, we're going to kick off with an interview with a good friend of the Skeptic Zone, Abhijit Chanda from India. And this interview is being conducted by Adrian Hill. And I'm looking forward to seeing Adrian Hill next week in Canada. Adrian chats to Abhijit about many things, including Ayurvedic medicine. Now, this is one branch of alternative medicine I know only a little bit about, so I found this interview very interesting. Following that, it's the return of the Book of Tim with Tim Mendham, recorded at the Skeptic Zone Studios, and Tim is going to be looking at a very early investigation by the Australian Skeptics into psychic surgery. In fact, this is story one in volume one of the magazine The Skeptic, published way back in 1981. Then to round off the show, the Trove Archives, part two of our series on Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, the creator of Sherlock Holmes. And this week, we're going to look for references to Conan Doyle's belief in fairies at the bottom of the garden, or fairies in the woods. A strange story indeed. And next week in the Trove segment, we're going to be looking at the relationship between Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, a staunch believer in the paranormal, and Harry Houdini, a famed debunker of fake psychics. Now, before we start, in Australia, I noticed that the teachers have gone back to their lessons in many parts of Australia. And to let you know, I'm thinking about you because I think what you do is a terrific job, and it can be very difficult and very stressful. So you teachers out there, up and down the coast, hats off to you. But now it's time for me to run into Brian Dunning's kitchen. Open the Skeptoid fridge. What do I find? I find some lovely cheese, Oregon cheese. While I eat that, I hope you enjoy the Skeptic Zone. You can count on Adrian. With Adrian Hill.
Hello everyone, this is Adrian Hill from Canada here, and I have a really special guest and friend with me today. Abhijit Chanda is joining me all the way from New Delhi, India, and he is the host of the podcast and YouTube channel called Rationable. So today I'm really happy to connect with Abhijit because we met originally in 2018 at PsyCon, and I believe we were both really at the beginning of our skeptical adventures. Is that correct for you?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I needed something to kind of give me that little push in the right direction, and that's what happened right there.
Yeah, and we were sitting in the front row of the very first workshop with Susan Gerbeck and Mark Edward. And the two of us were side by side, and we introduced each other to ourselves and found out a little bit about each other. And I believe I tried to recruit you to be a GSOW editor, even though I was just in training. I was just starting.
You're very good at sales, I'll give you that. Because I did sign up eventually.
Yeah, you did sign up. But then you decided, no, this isn't quite what you wanted to do. You wanted to take your own road. And you have done really well. So just describe a little bit about what you've been up to. And
first off, I want to give you my perspective of our first meeting, because
yes,
I was a complete stranger to this world, to the skeptical society, the community. And I had walked in, this was day one. I mean, first of all, I'm actually an introvert. Most people won't believe it, but I usually am because I need a lot of energy to kind of, okay, I'm going to talk to people. And I just sat down and I was like, okay, here we go. And I had no expectations at all. And you were so welcoming and so warm. And you started chatting with me immediately. And you've made me feel so welcome that it was like, okay, I can get through this. This is going to be fun.
Well, that's really interesting.
Thank you for that.
Oh, yeah, it was awesome to meet you. And what's really funny about you saying that is Susan will say that, because that's the first time I met Susan as well, that I kind of disappeared into the woodwork.
Did you now?
I
always saw you kind of towering above the woodwork.
Yeah, no, I was really quiet, especially around Susan, because she was at that time to me a bit of an intimidating figure just because, you know, she was head of this organization that I just joined.
I didn't even know who Susan was.
But when I sat next to you, that was the very first thing from PsyCon, and I was feeling the same way. It's funny, but I just turned to you and forced myself to start talking, and it was just very comfortable from the beginning. So I think that's pretty cool.
I'm so glad. That is so chill. Like, I thought you were like a, you know, total pro at this. Like, hey, I've been here a million times before. I know everybody.
I knew nobody. It was my first PsyCon.
I think we just kind of meant to hit it off. Absolutely fantastic.
So it's so nice to finally interview you. And the reason that I've asked you to come on the show is because I had kind of an interesting experience on my last trip on our cruise. I want to tell you a little story that happened. We had this lovely waiter from India. He was from Mumbai. Mm-hmm. And we like to be interested in people we sit by, the people who are working on the cruise ship, and we just like to ask questions. And so we were just asking him lots of stuff, and he was a great storyteller. And so he was telling us all about his family back home and where he lives and where his wife's from and what his kids are like. It was awesome. And then a few days later, we got into his magical cures. He was very much into Ayurvedic medicine, and he was really trying to teach us about it, which I found quite delightful, but also amusing. As you would know, he had no idea that I'm from a skeptical community, and I didn't think it was the time or the place to to set him straight.
You have to pick in a moment. Yeah.
Exactly. And we loved his stories, so we were interested. But the very first thing that he started talking about was something called Shilajit. And he said it cured his knees. He takes it every day. It makes him feel much better. It gives him energy, you know, the classic cure-all type of thing. But he sold it, right? He really said, this is amazing stuff. And so the first thing I did after dinner was reach out to you and ask, what is this stuff? And you had some interesting things to say. So tell us a little bit about this.
This is, it's very interesting. It's been in Ayurveda for a very long time, and it's called the oil of the Himalayas in some ways, or the tar of the Himalayas. It's a black, greasy substance. I'm not sure where it comes from. And it is something that can be found in the mountains. But it has recently become even bigger because there has this brand of alkaline water, which has come into the Indian market called Evocus. And it's everywhere. It's black water. It doesn't look very appetizing, but they claim that it has 70 or 80 different minerals in it. They don't have anything written on the ingredients label or the nutrition label.
Interesting.
So they've got it written on the front. They got nothing to show for it in the back. What they say is this thing called fulvic acid, which somehow an acid turns things alkaline. I don't understand how they think that works, but that was very interesting nonetheless. But fulvic acid is what they use in this water to make it black. And they say that it's the same kind of stuff that has been, that basically Shilajit is. So reading of the Wikipedia page, which I'm sure Susan would appreciate, humic substances are organic compounds that are important components of humus. Not hummus, humus. The top of the soil, the most fertile part of the soil, which is, and peat and coal. And also it's a constituent of many upland streams, dystrophic lakes and ocean water. Now, I'm not a geologist, so I'm not really sure exactly what that means. But basically, these humic substances like fulvic acid, you know, organic acids and compounds, which, you know, kind of are found in such areas. And Shilajit has been one of these things, which has been in use in Ayurveda for a very long time. And it's supposed to have some magical healing properties. But as you would rightly guess, I don't think there have been any studies, reliable randomized controlled trials done on fulvic acids and their effects on humans. At least none that I could find. So that's that. Now, of course, with Ayurveda, that's pretty much what everybody, I mean, even with homeopathy, people will swear by it. They say it made this rash go away and made this go away and it's done amazing things for this and that. But of course, it's got absolutely no foundation in reality. It's all, you know, confirmation bias, placebo effect. And of course, returning what is called regression to the mean, which is basically a lot of diseases or disorders tend to go back to a more maintainable stage where basically it disappears and it might come back at a later time. But people, of course, associate this with all sorts of things that they're doing at the time.
Right.
Same mechanism by footballers, you know, wear magic undies or socks. Lucky necklaces. And
don't wash their socks.
Anyway, but it's the same mechanism, basically. So that's the science or lack thereof behind Shilajit.
Well, interesting stuff. I'd never heard of it before. Of course, I had heard of Ayurvedic medicine. You brought it to my attention.
And of course, the thing is that a lot of people just assume that since this is natural, this is, again, the naturalistic fallacy, that because it's natural, you can just gulp it down and there's going to be absolutely no side effects. So of course, that is not usually the case. There is always, if there is an effect, there will be a side effect.
Right. Are there any known side effects, like risks if you take too much, etc.?
As far as side effects, you shouldn't consume it raw or unprocessed. You're just going to lick it off the mountain? What are you going to do?
Well, that was one of the stories he told us, was that, you know, memory is fickle, so I might not get this right. But what he was saying is that they'd observed monkeys licking the rocks that this was oozing out of. And they noticed that these monkeys lived longer. And therefore, they thought it might help humans. And it does, according to him. I thought that was an interesting story. You haven't heard that one.
I haven't heard that one, but it would be an interesting test to do to see how many people live longer, the ones who consumed Shilajit. It's going to be difficult because, you know, mainstream medicine has already made people live a hell of a lot longer than they used to.
That's right.
Which is why we are living in an age where we die more of lifestyle diseases and congenital diseases than we do of infections.
That's right. Yeah. Well, I just quickly looked up the monkey story. According to one of the sellers, this monkey story is actually ancient Indian folklore. So it is a story that's been carried down and passed down. It's not a study. And it's monkeys in the Himalayas would climb to the highest peaks to collect their Shilajit. And they were said to be able to live for hundreds of years and possess extraordinary strength and vitality thanks to the Shilajit they consumed. And they call it the monkey secret.
As far as humans are concerned, I don't think any of us as any Indians have lived to that level of, you know, even the most ardent Shilajit fans, I doubt.
Exactly.
I'm willing to be proven wrong, but I have a bad feeling about that.
Well, that's and that's what why learning about the culture, it is interesting. It's where does this stuff come from?
I mean, it's anecdotal evidence handed down a few hundred years.
Yeah.
Maybe a couple of thousand.
And it's also appealing to, what is that, the appeal to antiquity?
Exactly. Right? Appeal to antiquity, appeal to nature, appeal to monkeys. I don't know, we should make a new fallacy. But... Of course, in India, monkeys are considered holy in many ways by many people, because especially the, you know, the regular run-of-the-mill monkeys are supposed to have or be related to Hanuman, who is the monkey god, who was basically Ram's best friend from Ramayana.
Right.
So Ram is, again, another god king, now considered a god. Basically, the monkey god Hanuman came down to help him, and he carried mountains for him. He opened his heart. He literally opened his chest up and showed him the pureness of his heart, et cetera, et cetera, and helped fight off the bad guys. Yeah, so there's a lot of monkey business happening in our myths and legends, and a lot of it is taken very seriously. So. Right.
So not surprising that this was part of his story.
Exactly. That makes it even more appealing to mm-hmm. most Indians, I would imagine.
Well, fair enough. So the other thing that he brought up was that when he was 10 years old, he went to a palm reader. And I'm wondering, how prevalent is palm reading in India?
It's incredibly prevalent. Like everyone, basically. I mean, every second person will... If you meet at a party, you'll say, oh, yes, I have done studies on palm reading. And can I read your palm? And they're like, oh, very interesting. And, you know, they'll go through with it. So, and, you know, most of it is non-serious, or people have had maybe cursory knowledge or read a book about it or something of that sort. Some can be uncannily good at it. None that I have personally met. Palm reading is, there are institutes of palmistry all over the country. In fact, I went on a trek once. By the time we reached halfway, I was pooped. And I sat down and I noticed a young Caucasian man sitting there peeling peas. So I said, what are you doing here, if I may ask? And he said, well, I study at the palmistry school, you know, in the town, and I just walk up here every now and then and help these guys with their peas or whatever else needs to be done to cook their food and stuff like that. So I help bring up stuff and I take down stuff. I was like, oh, palmistry, that's very interesting. So would you like to read our palms? So there's a friend of mine who was sitting next to me, and she showed her palm and he read it and was like, oh, you're not from around here. It's just obvious. I mean, she's Chinese. And he went on and said a lot of things, and there was a full conversation happening. So she was saying some things and he was responding. And I thought, okay, you know what? When he comes to me, I'm not going to tell him anything.
Mm-hmm. He's really good at cold reading, it sounds like.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I just showed him my palm and I said, okay, go ahead. What do you think? He was like, So what is it that where are you from? I was like, you tell me, man. I ain't saying nothing. You're like, you're very hard to read. And I think we're done for today, but it's all right. I mean, maybe I'm just not having a good day. I might be a little bit tired. All right. No problem. It's cool. Go back to your peas. Long story short, it's extremely prevalent. Everybody does it. And it's seriously believed, it is taken very, very seriously by most people. So it's not something that nobody's mucking about. They're very serious about palm reading.
Interesting. Well, Abhijit, it has been such a pleasure talking to you today. And thank you so much. And I look forward to talking again soon.
It's my pleasure. And thanks for having me on.
Well, that's all for now. If you want to listen to more of what Abhijit has to say, check out his YouTube channel called Rationable, or listen to his podcast, The Rationable Podcast, found everywhere that podcasts are available. To get the latest episode soonest, The Rationable Podcast is now also on YouTube. Until next time, this is Adrian Hill. Adrian Hill from Canada here. For those of you who would love an excuse to visit Calgary, besides the maple syrup and mountains, the Western Canadian Reason, or We Can Reason Conference, is happening May 5th and 6th. We have a great lineup of both local and international speakers. We have science communicator and secular activist Aaron Raw, host of the Q-Dropped podcast, Courtney Hurd, host of the Divorcing Religion podcast, Janice Selby, co-host of the Squaring the Strange podcast and clever caricaturist, Celestia Ward, host of the Thinking Atheist podcast, Seth Andrews, noted pancake-eating expert, Richard Saunders. I'm so excited he's coming. And me, Adrian Hill. And now, Richard, besides eating pancakes and real Canadian maple syrup, what do you plan to do at the conference?
Well, if I'm not too full from pancakes, we might be at the Hotel Clique Friday, May 5 at 6 p.m. That's Calgary time, for registration and fun. Celestia will be drawing all your beautiful faces. Lois Edwards and Adrian will be holding a trivia competition, and I might be bending a spoon or three, because good things happen in threes, and folding some paper into Pigasus and magic rabbits.
Check out the website at www.wecanreason.com for more information on speakers, hotel, and activities. Hope to see you there, or you might be, you know, sorry.
And now, a reading from the Book of Tim with Tim Mendham.
Hi, my name's Tim Mendham. I'm the editor of the Skeptic's quarterly magazine, The Skeptic, and I'm executive officer of Australian Skeptics, Inc. And today, I'll be reading to you from a very precious document. This is the very first issue of our Skeptic magazine, which came out as a four-page tabloid size, rather sort of interestingly put together, but it's very rare. In fact, the copy I have is the only one in existence.
Tim, I've got one.
Okay, it's one of two in existence, right, that we have. Okay, now I'm getting our scientific archivist to bring out the copy in the box, so we'll... Thank you, Dolores. Okay, we know Dolores is a scientist because she's wearing a white lab coat. Okay, here we are, getting the copy in front of us. It's a bit fragile, so we have to be very careful with it, but here we are. This story is on the front page, it's the first story on the front page of the first issue of Australian Skeptics magazine, The Skeptic. And it represents the first investigation that we ever did. So it's pretty important historically. And it's called Skeptics Test Psychic Surgeon. It's written by Mark Plummer, who was then at that stage the president of The Skeptic and the editor of this glorious magazine. Now, I should point out, it's not psychic surgery as we know it. It's a different sort of psychic surgery, but you'll find that out as we go along. And the story goes, when a small paragraph advertisement in The Age, in a Melbourne newspaper, on January 3rd, 1981, stated that an English medium psychic, that's a medium as in the spirit world, not half done, medium psychic surgeon would be commencing practice in Melbourne, the Australian Skeptic swung into action. The advertised numbers were rung, and we were told that Mr. Roman Diakov acted as a medium for deceased surgeons to conduct psychic operations. An appointment was arranged for an elderly patient and her son, both in quotes, to attend for surgery. The patient was actually 73-year-old medical practitioner Dr. Miffy Beadnell, and her son was magician Mike Wilton, a committee member of the Australian Skeptics. Our team of Dr. Beadnell and Mike Wilton found that Mr. Diakov's clinic, located in a new villa unit at, well, I won't give the address, but it's in a Melbourne suburb of Kew. The family room of the villa was the reception area, and the receptionist nurse went to great lengths to reassure this seemingly fragile elderly lady that there would be no pain. We were informed there would be no blood either, as Mr. Diakov worked only on the psychic body. So the term surgery was a bit of a misnomer. The nurse assured our team that operations done to date had been very successful. Diakov left to prepare himself and donned a white coat. He's a scientist. Wilton was assured he would be able to observe the treatment in the bedroom, which became the operating theatre for the night. With dim blue lighting and the strains of Michael Row the Boat ashore, Dr. Beadnell was laid on the bed operating table. After a suitable brief prayer, Diakov slowly stood, then walked with a limp. He had adopted the plummy accent of a pommy Dr. Roberts. Dr. Roberts, this is the spirit that gets in his body, then examined Dr. Beadnell's cranium with a special invisible psychic microscope. Dr. Roberts amazed our team with the revelation that the brain was divided into two halves, the left and the right, stunning, and was composed of millions of cells. Dr. Roberts stated that several of these naughty cells were misbehaving themselves. This was explained in layman's terms as being akin to a car motor with loose spark plugs. The problem explained, the treatment began. Several special invisible psychic tubes were inserted through Dr. Beadnell's head, threaded through the body and came out through the soles of her feet. Then all the, quote, bad fluids were psychically drained from her body, in the brain, out the feet. This was followed by the passing of hands down the length of the body and the amazing discovery that one half of the patient's brain was hot. More passing of hands followed, but clearly a second opinion was needed. So Dr. Roberts left and Mr. Diakov's body and Dr. Maurice, supposedly a deceased French gynecologist, took over. Dr. Maurice's French accent had clearly deteriorated since his death, to say nothing of his diagnostic talents. For the diagnosis was that the patient's stomach pains were caused by displaced pelvic bones after the birth of her last child. Lying on the bed, at Dr. Beadnell couldn't remember having had any children, not even a miscarriage. Nevertheless, Dr. Maurice also diagnosed deafness in her left ear. Our patient couldn't remember deafness having ever been a problem either, but clearly this, like the birth of her various children, must have slipped her memory. Dr. Roberts returned then to wrap up the post-operative treatment. The good lady would have to come back for further treatment, naturally. She would feel quite tired over the next few days and must drink plenty of water. She would also pass more fluid than normal. And as Mark Plummer comments, one would hope that anyone drinking more water than normal would also pass more water than normal. Our team posed a few more questions for Dr. Roberts to find out that he was a practicing brain surgeon at St. Bartholomew's Hospital before dying in 1948. Before more questions could be put, Dr. Roberts had to depart, leaving us with Mr. Diakov to show our team out the door. The opinion of the Australian Skeptics testing team, in case you haven't guessed, is that the utterances of the doctors who operated revealed a complete lack of any medical knowledge, their diagnosis was wrong, and the hopeless French accent merely added to the conclusion that Mr. Diakov was false. Our finding confirmed that of an American Federal Trade Court Commission judgment in 1975 that psychic surgery and psychic healing is pure fakery and fraud accomplished by the deception and trickery of the psychic surgeons to deceive trusting persons into the false and mistaken belief that human bodies have been opened with the bare hands, disease material or disease-causing material removed, and the incision closed, all without pain or suffering. And Mr. Diakov, if you can reach him on the advertised phone numbers, please tell him the Australian Skeptics are wondering how to explain the item in their books, Psychic Surgery Fee, $20, to their auditors. And that's The Skeptic Magazine, Volume 1, Number 1, Page 1, and the first test that the skeptics ever did of a psychic surgeon. Not the sort who reaches into your body, but the one who drains the bad psychic spark plugs out of your body with the help of a badly accented French surgeon. And you can read that on the website by looking up Volume 1, Number 1, on the website on the magazine section of skeptics.com.au. You can download it for free and read the exciting story of Mr. Diakov whenever you like.
Dr. Harriet Hall, MD, known to thousands as the Skeptoc, was a retired family physician and former Air Force flight surgeon who wrote about medicine, so-called complementary and alternative medicine, science, quackery, and critical thinking. Harriet produced a free online course of 10 video lectures on science-based medicine and alternative medicine. The videos and an accompanying course guide can be found by following the link at skeptoc.info or by visiting tinyurl.com/skeptocseries. Topics covered in the series are science-based medicine versus evidence-based medicine, what is CAM, chiropractic, acupuncture, homeopathy, naturopathy and herbal medicine, energy medicine, miscellaneous alternatives, pitfalls in research, and science-based medicine in the media and politics. Harriet covers each topic in a matter-of-fact, no-nonsense way that is sure to educate and entertain. Find it at tinyurl.com/skepdocseries.
Back into the Trove archives at trove.nla.gov.au, of course the online resource from the Australian Government and the National Library of Australia, chock-a-block full of digital archives, digital recreations of newspapers and magazines and so on. Now, last week we looked at some references to the famous author Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, the creator of Sherlock Holmes. And we mentioned the fact that he believed in fairies at the bottom of the garden. And this was to do with the Cottingley Fairies incident, and according to Wikipedia. The Cottingley Fairies appear in a series of five photographs taken by Elsie Wright, 1901 to 1988, and Francis Griffith, 1907 to 1986, two young cousins who lived in Cottingley near Bradford in England. In 1917, when the first two photographs were taken, Elsie was 16 and Francis was 9. The pictures came to the attention of the writer Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, who used them to illustrate an article on fairies he had been commissioned to write for the Christmas 1920 edition of the Strand magazine. Doyle, as a spiritualist, was enthusiastic about the photographs and interpreted them as clear and visible evidence of psychic phenomena. Public reaction was mixed. Some accepted the images as genuine, others believed that they had been faked. It goes on to say, in the early 1980s, Elsie and Francis admitted the photographs were faked, using cardboard cutouts of fairies copied from a popular children's book of the time. But Francis maintained that the fifth and final photograph was genuine. As of 2019, the photographs and the cameras used are in the collections of the National Science and Media Museum in Bradford, England. And this page also, of course, has copies of the photographs themselves with the two young girls in the garden in the woods there, surrounded by dancing and flying fairies. And indeed, there's an excerpt from a book where the girls got the original illustrations from. Bearing all that in mind, let's have a look at some of the reports as reported here in Australia. And we start in the year 1920, on the 4th of December, in the Maitland Weekly Mercury. Fairies photographed. Conan Doyle's theories. The Times cable. London, November 25. That fairies actually exist and have been photographed is seriously asserted. The photographs have been reproduced and resemble storybook illustrations. One is shown playing a red pipe, another is pivoting on a toadstool. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle suggests that fairies are a compound of a butterfly and a human being. And now in the year 1921, the 15th of January, the Daily Telegraph, Sydney. The wee folk. Are they fairies? Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's belief. A remarkable story. Some very interesting statements in emphasis of the existence of fairies were made by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle in the course of an interview with a representative of the Daily Mail, Brisbane.
I consider this,
the famous Englishman said, and of course Sir Arthur Conan Doyle was Scottish, not English, but never mind,
to be the greatest thing that has happened in the way of discovery since Christopher Columbus discovered America.
It should be made clear that there is no distinct affinity between this subject and spiritualism proper. Herein lies the reason why Sir Arthur Conan Doyle has not previously touched upon the subject in Australia.
"I have not ventilated the question of fairy life,"
he said,
"because I was afraid it might obscure my main issue, which is, of course, the survival of the soul and the conditions under which it continues its career."
It was pointed out to Sir Arthur that cable messages had already referred briefly to his belief in the matter, and that there was a possibility of many people confusing fairies with human spirits, whereupon he said,
"Well, I have no objection to saying a few words now upon this subject, especially as the Christmas number of the Strand magazine is due here any day, and it will be found to contain two excellent photographs of these extraordinary little creatures. I look upon it as a great privilege in my life,"
he continued,
"that I have been permitted to follow up the clue which led to this strange development, and which gave actual proof of the existence of forms of life which have always been testified to by certain members of the human race, but which it has hitherto been impossible to prove. The story is briefly this. Two young children living in Yorkshire were accustomed to play in a wood behind their house, and they continually described to their father the fairies which they saw. The father, an intelligent working man, was quite agnostic and inclined to be sceptical. He was induced, however, to allow the children to use his camera, and when they returned in the evening with actual photographs of the fairies, all doubts were set aside. The family did not attempt to exploit the fact. On the contrary, they rather hushed it up. It was 3 years after I heard of the existence of these photographs, and, with the help of Mr. Gardner, a well-known theosophist, I traced them to their source. Mr. Gardner got hold of the negatives, and we had them submitted to well-known experts, who certainly could not be deceived by little village children. We enlarged the pictures 8 foot in an attempt to find some flaw, but we were quite unable to do so. We then interviewed everybody concerned and found that the family in question were honest, good people, quite incapable of senseless deception. In the meantime, the two children had been separated. Apparently, it is only when they are together that their mediumistic power is such that the fairies can use it. We therefore took some trouble to reunite the two children, after which we put them once more in the same wood, and furnished them with a new camera. I am not at liberty to say yet what the results were, as I am not in touch with Mr. Gardner, but I can go as far as to say that they were very astounding, and that they surpass those which we have published in the magazine. I consider this to be the greatest thing that has happened in the way of discovery since Christopher Columbus discovered America. In fact, it is a larger event than that, as it reveals a whole new world parallel to our own and divided by an exceedingly thin partition, which a child's hand has broken down. There are many psychic children. There are many cameras. There are many woods. We shall soon learn a great deal which will make our country walks infinitely more interesting.
In a reply to a question, Sir Conan Doyle said he could say nothing regarding the speech of fairies. From the fact, however, that a photograph showed one of the little creatures to be using a small musical instrument, it was evident that they had their own polity and domestic life. Now, there's a word that I was unfamiliar with. Polity, a form or process of civil government or constitution. Polity. The photograph in question, as shown by Sir Arthur, is certainly a very pretty picture, a fairy figure, harmonizing with the best human conception of the wee folk, is distinctly seen with a trumpet-like musical instrument to his lips beside the girl. In a second photograph, there is quite a troop of the daintily ethereal figures surrounding the child. And in yet another print, the girl is associating with a quaint little goblin. Well, try to put yourself back into the period of these photographs.
1917 and this report is from 1921. It's all very well with hindsight and looking at these photographs, seeing clearly that they're just cardboard cutouts. But at the time, and if you're especially inclined to believe in these sort of things, as Sir Arthur Conan Doyle was, well, we can all be fooled. And now from the year 1922, on the 9th of December, the Daily Mail from Brisbane. Conan Doyle's fairies. Sir Conan Doyle is at it again. He has just published a book about fairies, illustrated with portraits of them. Many big literary men make the boast of believing in fairies, and such belief is supposed to indicate great superiority of mind. Sir Conan, nevertheless, does not vouch for the authenticity of the facts he has gathered. However, it is quite probable, according to those fairy stories, that the kiddie of tomorrow will reject Grandad's story of Once Upon a Time with scorn by saying, quote, "Oh, but the fairies I was talking to today said that those yarns of yours are all bosh. They've no record of them in their history books," end quote. Now, of course, there are many more references to Sir Arthur Conan Doyle and photographs, but we'll end in the year 1983. 1983, on the 21st of March, the Canberra Times. Reputations in tatters. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle misses elementary clue. Famous fairy photos, fakes. London, Sunday. Australian Associated Press, Times. The reputations of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, creator of Sherlock Holmes, and the world's most famous fairies, are in tatters. Frances Griffiths, one of the two girls who created an international sensation more than 60 years ago with their photographs of the fairies in Cottingley, Dell, near Bingley, Yorkshire, has admitted to The Times, London, that the pictures were fakes. And Sir Arthur Conan Doyle was not simply taken in by two girls, then aged 10 and 16, but actually misinterpreted a vital clue when it was staring him in the face. Desperate for evidence of the paranormal, when he saw what was actually a hatpin holding down a cut-out illustration of a goblin, he described it as evidence of a fairy navel. Proof, he told fellow researchers into psychic phenomena, that the creatures reproduced in the same manner as humans. His findings sparked a bout of fairy fever in which Mr. Edward L. Gardner, National Secretary of the Theosophical Society, declared that fairies worked inside the stems of flowers, tinted petals, and gave warm green colour to the leaves. Mrs. Griffiths, now 76, has been dogged by the story of the Cottingley fairies all her life. She has promised to reveal the secrets of the fakes in a book she is writing. She said last week that most of the photographs were faked, using illustrations and hatpins, but insisted that one was genuine. The photographs were taken by Mrs. Griffiths and her cousin, Elsie Wright, in 1917. Elsie Wright, now 82, was reluctant to discuss her cousin's confession, but said she was proud of the one so-called genuine photograph.
"It was a brilliant idea,"
she said.
"Francis was not there at the time, and I just saw a way to take it. I have never even told my son and husband how I did it, and I will swear on the Bible that my father had nothing to do with it, but I will not swear on the Bible that they are real fairies."
Like her cousin, she is also promising to reveal nearly all in an autobiography. The story of the girls and their fairies was made into a BBC television program 5 years ago. They have always, until now, insisted the pictures were genuine. The photographs came to light when the girls, after being scolded for saying they were late because they were playing with fairies, borrowed a camera and later produced a photograph of several dancing figures. They took other similar pictures as their fame grew. The hunt for the truth about the fairies created small fortunes for several people, but all the girls received was the equivalent of $36 each. Now, to round off this segment, I'll play a short clip from a TV series made in the UK in 1991. James Randi, Psychic Investigator. Now, you can find this whole series on various places on YouTube, but this particular episode, or this part of this particular episode, dealt with the Cottingley Fairies.
The claims of spiritualism have been with us for years. In 1917, two young girls in Yorkshire fooled the world with these photos of fairies. One of their main supporters was the great writer Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, who was a fervent spiritualist himself.
And here we are by the Bavick Waterfall at the back of the Wrights' home in Cottingley, where photograph number one, the most important of all five, was taken by Elfie of Francis behind the cutout. I'm taking the place of Francis. For you see, it was the waterfall that was the clue to the whole thing that should have tripped everybody off with the secret of the hoax. The waterfall in the original picture is heavily blurred because it took at least a 10-second exposure to make that photograph, while the wings of the fairy are perfectly sharp and clear, and those wings should have been fluttering very rapidly. An obvious clue, but no one spotted it.
In later life, Elsie explained how she used these illustrations from a popular children's book.
I stretched them out to cut the gauze, and left a bit of gauze just round the waist and put the wings on, and then we cut them out.
Sir Arthur Conan Doyle and the Cottingley Fairies, a wonderful chapter in skeptical history. And you too can find out lots more wonderful chapters and articles and information when you visit Trove at trove.nla.gov.au. Put in your search, and you never know what you might find. Thank you for listening to the Skeptic Zone podcast. On next week's show, Tim Mendham turns the table on me and interviews me about skeptical investigations. We'll also have the Australian Skeptics newsletter and part three of our series on Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, where we look at the relationship between Conan Doyle and Harry Houdini. Also coming up on next week's show, some interviews from Canada, from the We Can Reason conference, or maybe not. Maybe it might be a bit too soon because it is on the weekend. Anyway, I'll see what I can do. Thank you to all those people who see what they can do and contribute to the Skeptic Zone at skepticzone.tv via Patreon or PayPal. Your contribution means the show keeps going. But for this week, from beautiful Bend in Oregon, this is Richard Saunders signing off. You've been listening to the Skeptic Zone podcast. Please visit our website at www.skepticzone.tv for show notes, contacts, and to access the back catalogue of episodes going back to 2008. You can follow the Skeptic Zone podcast on Twitter at Skeptic Zone, visit our Facebook page, or leave a review on iTunes. You can also support the Skeptic Zone via Patreon or PayPal. The Skeptic Zone podcast is an independent production. The views and opinions expressed on the Skeptic Zone are not necessarily those of Australian Skeptics or any other skeptical organisation.
I'm not used to this sort of, used to more professional.
Tim Mendham is in the Skeptic Zone studios and he's demolishing the studios. The panelling's coming down.
You can't work
under these conditions.
They didn't have the mustiques,
well,
honestly.
Yeah, and we forgot the black jelly beans.
I'm leaving. I'm sorry, it's not good enough, right?
The beer's downstairs. Book of Tim. Let me, can you pass me that notepad up there?
Yeah. With all the delicate stuff on it.
All the delicate stuff on it, that's right. Thank you. So, Bot, in other words known as Book of Tim, and this is volume one.
And you're putting the soporific music from
Yes, number one, yes.
But as music goes, it's very, very relaxing. Volume one, number one. What's the article called?
It's actually called Skeptic's Test Psychic Surgeon by Mark Palumber.
Ah, it's article one. Okay.
It is.
All right, this is the book of Tim, and you'll be able to hear me clearly, right? You can hear me clearly now.
Try to.
In the recording, it's only your microphone
right. That's
going to be used. All right.
If it can pick up my stomach, it's going to pick up you in the background.
Well, I won't make it.
Except for when I say,
yes,
this is the only copy in existence.
That's right.
And then you say,
no, it's not.
They say, I've got one.
I've got one. All right.
Please, get the line right.
I can't work under this.
Can you believe it? Can you be?
I can believe it.
Okay.
I'll say it as a Greek god.
No.
I've got
one. No, you say it as a rather pathetic figure in the background. Is it really one?
I am a rather pathetic figure.
There we are. Okay. Ready?
Yep.